Driver Sam, has the driver time to see any of this? Is he conscious of it?
Oh, absolutely. You see them. I remember it was a sort of collective consciousness, them waving at you, you waving back.
Well, that's what it is now. Let's have a look at our color weather map. The green areas are good weather. Indianapolis right in the center. That looks like we'll have clear weather for the race. However, that black area out there is over Kansas City. They're having a bad time right now weather-wise. Let's have a specific look here right now at the weather conditions as reported to us. Temperature 72 degrees. Of course, that's in the shade, and the sun is shining. Humidity 70%. It's kind of a muggy day. Little or no wind. Chance of rain 40%. It doesn't look like that right now, however. Cars there moving. It's time then to meet the people who are inside these cars. Let's have a look at row number one. Rick Mears, the pole sitter and a former winner on the Roger Penske team, is the fastest qualifier in history. His teammate, Kevin Cogan, second fastest ever in only his second 500. Driving in his 25th 500 is the only four-time winner of the event, the 47-year-old driving legend from Texas, A.J. Foyt. Now in the second row. Mario Andretti looking for another Indy win 13 years after his 1969 victory, driving for Pat Patrick. As does Gordon Johncock, another former winner, positioned next to teammate Andretti. Outside him is Bill Whittington, one of three Whittington brothers who have qualified for today's race. Bill was fastest of the three. In row three, Tom Sneva has finished second in the 500 three times, but he still looks for victory number one. Don Whittington, eldest of the brothers, is a former winner of the Le Mans 24 Hours with brother Bill. Danny Ongais is back, remarkably so, after his terrifying crash in last year's race. We move to row number four. Pancho Carter is the son of an Indy driver, now appears in his ninth 500-mile classic. Chip Ganassi is a 24-year-old rookie from Pittsburgh, just graduated from Duquesne University. Johnny Rutherford has won here three times, but hasn't started this far back in 5 years. Row number five. Rookie Danny Sullivan comes to the Speedway with an impressive career in road and endurance racing. Herm Johnson is another rookie from Wisconsin, up from the ranks of Super V racing. And Hector Rabaque of Mexico rounds out an all-rookie row. He comes from the Formula One world. Let's look at the sixth row. Al Unser is a three-time winner, but started in one of the first two rows in each of those victories. Bobby Rahal is another rookie from road racing, winner of Daytona's 24 Hours last year. Howdy Holmes, the smallest in the race at 5'5", was a good seventh in 1979 as a rookie. Now the seventh row. Roger Mears is the brother of pole sitter Rick Mears. Jeff Brabham is the son of Grand Prix champion Jack Brabham. And Dennis Firestone appears in his third Indy 500. Row number eight. Michael Chandler is the son of the editor-in-chief of the LA Times. Dale Whittington is the youngest of the Whittington brothers. And Jim Hickman is a rookie, a rancher turned racer. Here is the ninth row. Johnny Parsons, son of an Indy winner, makes his eighth appearance here. George Snyder, a veteran in his 17th 500. And Tony Bettenhausen, namesake of a famous father. Row 10. Jerry Sneva is the brother of Tom Sneva. Chet Phillip is the first bearded driver here in 46 years. And Gary Bettenhausen is the elder brother of Tony. The 11th and final row. Tom Bigelow is a veteran from Winchester, Indiana. Halsmer is a Purdue graduate in his second race here. And Jose La Garza is the Mexican hero starting in the final position. A remarkable circumstance this year that there are four sets of full brothers in the race, including the three Whittington brothers. And there's one set of half-brothers, Johnny Parsons Jr. and Dwayne Carter. But now the great scene, once again, it's so well worth looking at, Sam.
Oh, absolutely, Jim. Just look at that as they're coming down there. I might say, too, 30 Americans in the race and three foreigners.
Okay, well, now Jack Whitaker is in that pace car with the flashing light. He's the only man in the back seat. His first time at Indy. Let's go to Jack Whitaker.
All right, Jim, we're in turn number one of this pace lap, and I'm excited and scared. I don't think I felt like this since World War II. The wind rushing through the open roof of this pace car, the masses of people over here to the right, and that great white wall, all are very daunting. We We have Jim Rathman, though, the 1960 Indianapolis champion, driving this pace car. We're in good hands, and look at the payoff I get looking out this rear window. Behind me here, the 33 racing cars getting ready in this pace lap, straining at the accelerators now as they have to keep down to the speed of this pace car, waiting for us to get out of the way so that they can take the green flag and go on their flying start. Around now to turn number two we are, past the VIP boxes with three balconies jammed with people, and the infield across the way, just one sea of humanity. This race is very close now to being on. We're picking up speed as we go down this back stretch. The closest cars to me, of course, the blue and white Penske's of Kevin Coogan and Rick Mears, but a colorful sight as you see, the red, the black and yellows, 33 of the most sophisticated racing machines in the world and the best drivers. This is the moment of the Indianapolis 500. The anticipation is over. We're about to get underway. We have helicopters above the Goodyear blimp. 350 to 400,000 people. We're in turn number three, so let's send you back to Jim McKay.
All right, Jack, has to be one of the thrills of a lifetime. Jack Whitaker on his first trip to Indy, riding in the pace car. There is the first row again. Remember, it's Mears on the inside. Car number one, Coogan number four in the middle, his teammate. On the outside, four-time winner, A.J. Foyt. Second row, Andretti in the 40, Johncock in 20, their teammates on the Pat Patrick team. Bill Whittington on the outside. A look at the crowd once again. In a scene that just about literally, Sam, beggars description.
It does, Jim. It's very, very hot here. It's in the high 80s and getting hotter steadily. Remember that these drivers have not driven since Thursday here.
Pace car is off the track, but they must await the green flag before the race is underway. Watch the starters platform on the left there. It's still not out. They appear to be in pretty good order in the first five or six rows at any rate. A little bit ragged towards the back. And look out, a crash before the start of the race.
Jim, that's one of the most extraordinary things I've ever seen. Remember, they were going about 130, 140 miles an hour when that started, but there is just no explanation, and now one of the favorites is totally out of the race.
And Dale Whittington's car is up against the wall. That's one of the three Whittington brothers. Number 40 you saw there was Mario Andretti. There is the number four car of Kevin Coogan that appeared to start it all.
Roger Mears is out of the race with a damaged right front. Jim, this is absolutely...
Well, we've seen many, many, many unexpected things, but never a crash even before the green flag fell for the start of the race. We had a terrible crash just after the start back in 1973. That was when Saltwalter spun, started it, rode up the wire caging. 10 or 11 cars were involved. There you saw Coogan trying to explain things.
To Andretti, poor Andretti spent the entire month here. Mario has getting ready. There's Kevin Coogan.
And now we have a red flag, Sam. That means the race is officially stopped. Remember, it didn't start, but it is officially stopped. It's not just a yellow situation. Let's look at it again. The middle of the front row, just behind him, is Johncock. A little out of order.
Yes, but now Coogan just looks absolutely fine. He just veers. It's as if he turned the wheel intentionally, Jim.
Just unbelievable. And that was Andretti coming right into him, into the side of his car from the inside of the second row.
That's Andretti now backwards.
Yeah.
Look at the height that wheel reached back in the back of the pack, where on the right of your screen, that's Roger Mears.
Dale Whittington in the yellow car up against the wall.
That tire bouncing along. That's Andretti's car stopped with its back to you on the right.
Maybe you noticed the yellow flag came out instantly.
Instantly, yeah. The officials can't be faulted in any way. They've handled this beautifully. There it is.
Somebody has a...
Unbelievable. And of course, he hit A.J. Foyt really hard, Jim. And it may be Foyt's luck not to have had his car damaged in any way. I've never seen anything happen on a racetrack for which there was
explanation. Well, now you and Jackie have been saying if there ever have been odds on favorites in this race, it's the two cars of the Penske team. One of those cars is gone, and the race hasn't even started yet. A red flag situation, as you see. Pole, which are all those positions are already confused. They'll have to reorder the cars, may have to have some sort of new rule for the start. This one isn't in the rule book, I don't think.
No, it certainly isn't.
All right, tell you what we're going to do. break here at Indianapolis, and then we'll return. Of Kevin Cogan, any new thoughts, Sam?
No, Jim, they were coming up very, very slowly to the start. There's certainly the possibility that when he punched the throttle, the car somehow went out of control.
Look at this. This was Cogan earlier. This is videotape of Kevin Cogan trying to talk to Andretti, Andretti appearing to push him away. He doesn't want to listen, doesn't want to hear. Mario Andretti, very, very upset. Now, our reporters are fanning out, trying to get the principals. Bill Fleming is with Mario Andretti right now. Okay. All right, Bill.
Mario, I couldn't hear what you said.
I said, this is what happens when you have children doing a man's job up front. That's what happens.
Somebody come right across in front of you.
Yeah, Cogan, you know, just, I guess, messed up and his side was in front of me. I just had no choice but T-bone him.
All right, well, there's A.J. Foyt. He was just talking to Cogan for a moment. Had some choice words for him, no doubt. Now, Economaki, Chris Economaki, moving in on A.J.
AJ, how'd that start?
Well, I don't know. He ran right square in my goddamn left front.
What are you talking about?
Cogan?
Cogan. Or AJ Foyt blames it on Kevin Cogan. Back to you, Jim.
Well, A.J. blames it on Kevin. We haven't heard from him yet, the man who obviously was the principal figure. There's A.J.'s car. Chris Economaki now with Kevin Cogan. All right, Chris.
Kevin, tough break at the start. Can you describe what happened?
Well, all I know is we were moving down nicely and started to accelerate, and the car just moved to the right. There's a tire mark on the right side of my car. I don't know what happened.
What kind of shape is your car?
It's finished.
A.J. Foyt sort of puts the blame on you. Do you feel you might be responsible?
I don't think so. I didn't do anything wrong. I didn't do anything out of the ordinary. Just veered to the right. I had to take a look at the film because it's no point in me saying that somebody pushed me or anything like that until I take.
You're okay. I'm disappointed, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. Very.
Kevin Cogan, 26 years old, finished fourth in this race as a rookie last year. Another replay. He's in the middle of the first row. Watch him.
Well, he speaks of wanting to see the film, Jim, to clear this thing up. I don't know what he's going to find out when he looks at it, honestly.
Oh, Mario Andretti just T-boning him on the side. There was nothing at all that Mario could do.
Mario, very lucky not to be injured in that. Did you notice? He almost went underneath Cogan's car, which would have been, of course, terrible if it had scraped up over his head.
Man who may have seen something is Gordon Johncock. He was directly behind Kevin Cogan as they moved towards the start. Let's get a word from Johncock now.
Well, Gordon Johncock had the $75 seat for that one, I guess, huh, Gordy? Can you describe
that?
Could you describe what happened and what your feelings were?
Well, I think we came down for too slow a start to begin with, Chris. And Kevin got on it, and the car got sideways with him a little bit, and he veered off in and touched Foyt. And then he came back across the track, and Mario nailed him broadside.
And you think the reason was too slow a start?
Well, it's one thing, definitely too slow a start, I feel. You know, I think you should come down through here in third gear where you don't have all that torque and horsepower to spin the wheels and break them loose, and we wouldn't have them problems.
Now, there's A.J. Foyt. Some of the veterans had concern about the younger drivers in this race because of the tremendous speeds this year. Seems to be proving true. Let's go to Chris again.
I'm standing by the front of A.J. Foyt's marge. What happened in the crash was Kevin Cogan's car nicked his and bent the left front steering arm. This rod here was bent, and that made the front wheels pigeon-toe. That appears to be the only damage, and crewmen over here are replacing that rod. Now, they can get it replaced all right, but whether the steering will be as precise as necessary, that remains to be seen. A crew will definitely have this car fixed, but only A.J. Foyt will know whether it's fixed right once the car gets on the track. A.J., will they be able to get the geometry right, do you think, on this repair job?
I think we can hit it pretty close. We're just guessing. We don't have time to put the strings up on or anything, so we're just really guessing, Chris.
What will it mean if it's out, A.J.?
They just won't hardly be able to drive it or be very competitive at all. If it's too bad, I'll have to park it.
Well, you heard Mario Andretti say that they had children doing a man's job in the first row. Let's get more word from him now.
Yeah, well,
what was his explanation?
The usual alibi. He said a Foyt hit him.
Would you like to see some changes in the rules for the young drivers?
Well, I don't know. I think there's nothing you can put in the rules. I think this is all up to the discretion of the car owners. I think, in my opinion, Roger Penske has a car that's too good for a person like him, obviously, because the kid can be more dangerous than anything else.
Is this something you don't see or can't discern during practice, during qualifications?
No, of course not. In fact, I had a run-in with him in practice where he just all out of the blue, he jumped out in a groove in front of me. I almost crashed into the back of him, and And I tried to go up and talk to him like a father, if you will, and he wouldn't even listen, you know.
Does Roger Penske talk to you?
No.
What sort of personal disappointment is this to you, Mario?
Oh, I'm throwing everything away that I worked for very hard up to this point. I mean, it's the biggest disappointment that I could ever describe. I don't think I can describe it.
Is it a bigger disappointment than last year's ruling on the race?
Well, of course, because I had never had a shot at even going through the first turn. And, you know, diligently we worked on it. I think we were well prepared to give a battle here. And you'd like to have a chance at the battlefield. And obviously I'm denied that chance by a situation like this.
What will you do now for the rest of the day?
Cry.
That was Clyde Lee with Mario Andretti, who was talking about Kevin Cogan. Of course, there's Roger Penske, the team manager of Cogan's team. Let's go down to Bill Fleming. He's near him.
Roger, let me get you here for a quick comment. I just talked to Mario Andretti back in Gasoline Alley, and he much has said that, as far as he was concerned, Kevin Cogan wasn't qualified to drive that car.
Well, obviously, this is a tough situation for Mario being knocked out of the race. I feel bad for him and for everybody else involved. But I've seen a lot of things happen, you know, at racing, and I think that's a pretty strong statement at this point. Kevin's done a good job for us, and obviously he's a man driving on our team, and I'm going to back him. It's unfortunate what happened, and who knows?
Can you make anything out of all of that as they move A.J. Foyt's car back out?
I don't know, Jim. You know, Cogan getting that ride was a lot like the traditional scene where the Hollywood producer, the famous producer, picks the unknown, you know, for the coveted role. And I guess it hasn't come out very well.
All right, they're still under the red flag, and there is an annoyed A.J. Okay, Sam Posey in the commentary booth. We're about to get not a restart, but another attempt to get a start in the Indianapolis 500. The green flag never fell before the crash. We have had about a 45-minute delay. You'll notice that one car is missing from the first row, another car missing from the second row. On the front now row, we now have just Rick Mears and A.J. Foyt. Kevin Cogan is gone. Second row, just Gordon Johncock and Bill Whittington. Mario Andretti is gone. The third row is the first one that's intact. Tom Steva, Don Whittington, and Danny Ungaez. But there is the first row, an unusual sight for the start of the Indianapolis 500, Sam.
Well, of course, the big question, Jim, is how is Foyt's car? He can't tell at this point, but when they get up to speed, he'll know.
Stand by on the left of your screen is starter Duane Sweeney. Still no green flag. There it is. They're racing at Indianapolis. And it's Mears and Foyt going into the first turn. A.J. Foyt, it appears, going for the lead. He's got the lead. A.J. Foyt quickly snatching the lead. Those are firecrackers, remember. That is not a crash or anything. The noise you hear in the background. It's a tradition at Indianapolis on the start. A.J. Foyt quickly going up to a fast lead in a car that had to be repaired under the red flag.
Amazing courage to be able to do that, Jim. Almost anybody else you would think would have given himself a turn or two to feel it out. Not A.J. Foyt.
He has not taken a small lead. He's taken a big lead. There you see Gordon Johncock in car number 20, the red and blue car, in third place. The two Whittingtons are together back there, Bill and Don, the two remaining Whittingtons. Dale Whittington was in the crash with the first attempt at the start and is out of the race. A.J. Foyt and Rick Mears are spreading it out very, very quickly. Moving back to third place again, we've got Gordon Johncock and Tom Steva, then the Whittingtons, the brothers side by side.
Yes, and it's in tight traffic like this where the turbulent air may cause these ground effects that I spoke of earlier not to work quite as well as they should. So whenever the cars are packed together, we have a potential for danger.
All right, there go the lead cars, and now the other cars spread out in the field. Third, fourth, and fifth, once again, is Johncock and Steva and Whittington. But up front, A.J. Foyt and Rick Mears. It had been expected, certainly, wouldn't you say, Sam, that Mears would be the man to take the lead?
I certainly thought he would, and as a matter of fact, he is not letting Foyt get any further ahead. Mears, well, there's Garza, there's Jose Lee Garza posting. He was the
Rookie of the Year last year, that's right, and now it appears out of the race just that quickly. Now back to the leader again, A.J. Foyt. There's Rick Mears in the blue, the traditional orange car. Super Tex, as they call him, A.J. Foyt. There's the speed shot.
Mears, of course, probably trying to be very, very cautious at this point because he is the only remaining Penske entry.
And incidentally, it's Don Whittington who is up among the leaders. He started a row back of his brother, car number 91, Don Whittington. Not Bill, who was in the second row. Look at the way Foyt is spreading it out.
What? This could be because Foyt has turned his boost up, Jim. The turbocharger boost, which allows you to run a few laps very, very fast at the expense of the fact you're using up a lot of fuel. Foyt may have made the decision to lead early, but this may not be a lead he's able to keep. What it convinces me of, though, is that his car, his chassis, is all right. They've been able to repair it properly after the accident.
But as you said, it took tremendous courage going into turn one when he did not know how the car was going to handle to go for the lead.
Foyt is one of the most remarkable racing drivers, I think, ever to get into the cockpit of a car, and this is proof positive. Here he is in his 25th Indianapolis, and he's leading it with everybody else out behind him.
There's Garza parked, just about parked. Young man from Mexico, his team manager, the man who won this race last year and declined to defend his championship because he was going to manage Garza's team, Bobby Unser. Bobby Unser and his day's work apparently is done. Back up in front, the 47-year-old four-time winner of Indianapolis, only man ever to do that, Anthony Joseph Foyt Jr. of Houston, Texas.
In second place, Rick Mears has to be trying to feel out his car, get the sense of the pace. In many ways, he is still absolutely the favorite, I think, in my mind, in the minds of many other people. But at this point, he's got to be looking at Foyt and wondering, how's he staying out there in front of me?
And A.J. Foyt has taken so many approaches to this race successfully. Don't they have to be wondering a little bit, the Penske people, what's he up to?
Yes, because in qualifying, when he had shown not very much speed during the practice, all of a sudden, when it counted, he had the speed. Suddenly, he has it again.
He particularly has the speed on the straightaway as opposed to in the corners, where the Penske cars seem to handle the best of anybody. So it's A.J. Foyt leading the Indianapolis 500 once again. We'll be right back. Leading 500, but Rick Mears is closing in on him. Foyt, who appeared in his first Indy 500 in 1958. Dwight Eisenhower was the president then, and the man just behind him at the moment, Rick Mears, was 6 years old. A.J. then in his 25th Indianapolis 500. Again, if you don't follow motor racing, he's won this race more often than any other man, four times, going for an unprecedented fifth. Boy, this is good racing right now in traffic.
It certainly is, as they're just starting to lap the tail enders for the first time. You know, Jim, Rick Mears, an extraordinary guy. Most drivers refuse to believe, really, in their own natural gifts as a driver. Instead, they feel it is only the force of their individual will which carries them forward in a race. I think Foyt is characterized by that. But Mears is willing to lay back a little bit, let things develop, and I think you're seeing him do that here now.
Great respect for his machinery. A.J. Foyt in traffic right now, about to pass, I believe that's Chet Phillips, the bearded driver. Mears not too far behind him.
Remember, Mears is driving this race with some damage to his fingers. He hurt them in an accident when he was tuning his car up a few weeks ago, so that is a question mark for him, too. Look at Foyt trying that outside pass, Jim. That is very, very dangerous as he went around Phillip. A very gutsy move by A.J. Foyt.
Of course, the talk in the pits is still of the accident, but these men can't think about that. They must concentrate every split second that they're on the racetrack.
It has to be put totally behind them.
That's right, but down in the pits are still wondering what in the world happened to Kogan's car. Let's go to Bill Fleming now with Bobby Unser.
You saw what happened on the first start of the race. Now, you're a veteran. You've been in many, many 500s. You've won it three times. Did you see anything at the start, for instance, that Mario complained about with Kogan cutting him off?
Well, I think really what happened, and the films will probably show it, is that the start number one was way too slow. So much too slow, I don't even know how to emphasize it. And after that, Kevin was in first gear like Rick would have been, or in his second, because they have a five-speed transmission. And I don't think Kevin was experienced with the type of rim wheel torque that they would develop in what normally we call first gear. And the car just got sideways on him, I'm sure, and I'm sure that's what the films will show. And I think that very, very sad that guys with that much experience can't do a better job of starting a race than that. That was a little bit of change up.
Well, there's the opinion on the crash of the man who won this race last year, Bobby Unser. Here's the current leader, A.J. Foyt Jr. Battle for second place shaping up between Rick Mears in car number one and Gordon Johncock in car number 40. You might point out, too, whose responsibility it is to control that speed. Unser talk about the start being too slow. Car 20 is Gordon Johncock. Car 40 was his teammate Mario Andretti.
And the responsibility for the pace as they come up to that flag at the start is Rick Mears. As you see him just pulling out there, and it was his responsibility that they had such a slow start.
Because he was the pole sitter,
exactly.
The fastest qualifier.
Exactly. Bunched up here behind George Snyder with that Dayglow helmet. It's interesting, Snyder used to be A.J. Foyt's teammate, Jim.
Couldn't be helping his old buddy a little bit. You don't do that at 200 miles an hour, do you?
Well, you can't say that he doesn't. There's Johncock making a sensational run. Looks as if he's got...
He does.
Gears. Yeah, Johncock's got some horsepower, Jim.
Gordon Johncock in car number 20, passing Rick Mears in car number 1. Mears the pole sitter. Johncock sat in the middle of the second row, was just behind Kevin Cogan on the crash, but was fortunate enough or skilled enough to avoid getting involved in it.
The car that George Snyder is currently holding them up with, and it's interesting, they've made a whole lap, and they've come up behind Snyder, but now they can't get by him. That is the sister car to the one that Gordon Smiley was killed in two weeks ago, Jim, going into the third turn here at the track.
So as Snyder holds them up, that gives Foyt the opportunity to keep spreading out his lead. He's got quite a sizable lead right now.
Yeah, he's streaking ahead. I can't say it's team tactics, and yet it sort of looks like that.
Okay, it's Foyt in the lead at Indianapolis. Foyt is in the center of the picture at Indianapolis. This time, for a very simple reason, he's leading the race again. Jackie Stewart is in ABC Sports Race Central. He, of course, saw that crash on the start and has been watching other things. So let's have a word now from Jackie Stewart.
Unquestionably for me, the focus so far in this 500, of course, is the start line accident. What occurred? Well, as soon as the accident happened, I rushed over to Kevin Cogan's garage to see what he had to say about it in the quietness of that garage. Frankly, he doesn't really know what happened. He doesn't know whether it was a mechanical failure or whether it was a driver error. He thinks not, however. Many very strong things are being said by other drivers about his inexperience. But what could have happened? Let's have a look at the tape one more time and see if we can analyze. What might have happened, a drive shaft on the right-hand side of the car could have sheared, and therefore the car could have pivoted towards the right and therefore driven in to A.J. Foyt, as it's doing right now. If that were the case, the drive shaft failure could certainly cause such an accident. Kevin Cogan has started many races before. Even though he's very young, he's driven in Grand Prix Formula One races, and of course that's a standing start, and they have roughly the same sort of horsepower at the standing start. So therefore the kind of accident that he had, from my point of view, should not be through lack of experience. However, this is a big race and a big day for a young man. What will ever happen? With regards to other things, A.J. Foyt for me is a man possessed. Certainly, he's driving like a young A.J. Foyt. I've never seen him drive so hard. He was so angry after the start of the race that he seemed to get in there, put his race face on, and drive with a sort of grit and determination that perhaps we haven't seen for 10 years. Mario Andretti surely must be the most disappointed man here at the Speedway. A real chance of winning the race. You know, for 12 years, Mario Andretti has split his interest from Grand Prix racing to IndyCar racing, from qualifying in Belgium and Monte Carlo to slipping over here to try and do the race in a half-hearted way. This year, he gave everything to the 500, and he's out of it. Very sad for him. Now back up to Jim McKay.
All right, Jackie, if you've just joined us, there was a crash before the start of this race triggered by Kevin Cogan's car going out of control. It took out of the race Mario Andretti and other cars, and that's what Jackie Stewart was talking about, just in case you joined us late. A.J. Foyt continues to lead the race right now, with Gordon Johncock in second place, Rick Mears third, and we're nearing the first pit stops under the green, I should think.
We are, and Jim, we still have an extraordinary situation. Snyder on the left of your screen, car number 35, has been holding up Johncock. Johncock making a bid there, though. He finally got the size of Snyder and was able to pass him right at the end, but Snyder, in effect, held up both Johncock and Mears, who's in third in the picture there, while Foyt made a good lead there, was able to get ahead.
Right. Foyt is well ahead of the cars you were seeing in the picture right now. He's going to come in for a pit stop. By the way, we can report no one was injured in that crash from the start. No injuries. There's Rick Mears also coming in. Now, this is where the pit crews take over from the drivers, and it's vitally important.
That's very rough pit lane that you just saw him come down. Now, it's an interesting experience to sit in the car during a pit stop like this. The fuel going in on that hose, it's actually cool on your back, Jim. It's almost an organic feeling of that fuel coming into the car and that the car dropping back down. And funny, it's more disorienting to the driver to be in the pits, really, than it is out on the track. The track is his environment. And now as Rick Mears goes back out onto the track, he's getting back up to the speed at which he feels comfortable.
Immaculate Penske pit stop. Now A.J. Foyt coming into the pits. Here he is, bumping along that rather uneven pit row.
Exceptionally rough, especially back there where they're coming into the pits in the early part at very high speed. Let's watch his stop.
Okay, now the chief of this pit row is the man in the driver's seat. A.J. Foyt runs the whole operation.
He certainly does. Look at him. He's very excited, Jim. He's doing a superb job. Look at that little bit of extra plastic on the windshield. Foyt's a tall man. He needs to get the air stream smoothed up over his head. He gets away very, very well. Good stop for AJ.
Now, Gordon Johncock is now the leader of the race in car number 20. Notice that the numbers, as we show them to you, are color key to the dominant color of the race car. You notice that all through the program. Okay, Gordon Johncock with the lead. However, he is going to have to pit very shortly here. And here he comes.
Again, let's watch him on that incredibly rough entry. It's the only part of the track that hasn't been repaved recently. Look at that rear wing shake, Jim, as he comes in here. He's still doing about 90 miles an hour, and they have to perfectly judge their stopping distance. Jim, that's a very hard thing to do exactly right, but it's something that these men are expert at doing. They're changing both the outside wheels, which is unusual so early in the going.
And now, as all three leaders have pitted, the leader on the race course is car number 91. That's Don Whittington of the three Whittington brothers, one of whom crashed on the start, two of them still in the race. Okay, Gordon Johncock going out. As we said, pit stops, a very artistic and a very scientific matter these days. There's the leader, Don Whittington, by the way. But pit stops, as we said, vitally important in this sport. We thought you'd like a demonstration of how they work as opposed to the family car in the gas station. Jackie Stewart did it earlier.
Making a visit for minor service in your neighborhood gas station is not quite the same as what happens when a race driver enters pit lane at Indianapolis.
Can I help you?
When a car comes in there, maybe doing 200 miles an hour on the main straight before he gets in there, the pit crew have to be quick. Not quite the same as the leisurely pace in your neighborhood store. And if you're very lucky, maybe two attendants will look after the needs of your family car. But then again, it's maybe 20 gallons of gas, and what's the hurry? But when Rick Mears comes in this demonstration here, it's 40 gallons of alcohol that goes in. Five men are over the wall. Maybe eight stops in the 500-mile race. 300 feet a second is 200 miles an hour on the racetrack, and 11 or 12 seconds is what's needed to get that car back out. But back home, it's the old handjack again. Get it under the car, get the little spin wrench out there, get the hubcap off, and leisurely, in a very peaceful way, get the wheel off. But at Indy, it's a very different story. Air jacks, when that gets plugged in, all four wheels raise off. Two tire specialists who look after changing wheels alone are in charge of that, while the rest of the crew are working hard. The crew chief is the man who gives the order, who masterminds it all and lets them go.
Wheels in, get ready to go. Go, go.
To a race driver, the only cost is time.
Gas and tires, that would be $308.12.
Okay, a little bit different in the pits than in the family gas station. The leader is still A.J. Foyt. There you see Mears and Johncock, Steva, and Don Whittington now back in fifth because while we're away, he took his pit stop under the green as the others had before. So Whittington dropping back, A.J. Foyt, the leader, in orange car number 14. There it is on the right of your screen.
All right, well, now we're looking at what they, the, so to speak, dreaded ground effect, Jim, because in order to corner properly, these cars need a clear flow of air underneath the car. And obviously, when they're in and out of traffic, zigzagging like this, they don't quite get that. And that means that, like right there, Foyt following that other car, he may not have quite the same grip that he would if he was in clear air.
By the way, the car just in front of A.J. Foyt is Al Unser. Spencer, a three-time winner of this race. Twitch has won it four times, but Al is well back in the pack. There's Roger Penske. Brain working furiously in his pits, right?
Oh, you bet. He controls the race for Rick Mears, deciding how much fuel should be pumped into the car, whether tires should be changed, and so on.
One thing you can be sure of, there is no panic in those pits, not at this point in the race. But Foyt continues to lead. The lap's going by. We're well into the race now at Indianapolis. We'll be back. Back again at Indianapolis. Rick Mears, the favorite in the race, again in the lead. Gordon Johncock second now, remember. Tom Stevens dropping back to third because of the trouble on the pit stop. Pancho Carter fourth. Those four cars still in the same lap. And there you see Mears, number one, just behind him. The light blue car with the red trim is number 20, Gordon Johncock. He's been out of the picture for a long time to get the green flag, but now he's right back in the thick of it again.
Well, yeah, and now that Mears is ahead instead of behind, it'll be interesting to see what happens.
All right, now we have 40 laps left. That's just 100 miles. Wouldn't this be the time for Mears to move it out if he's capable, as we thought originally? Look at this. Well, that answers the question unspoken. Gordon Johncock has taken the lead in Indianapolis.
Well, he just surged right by him, Jim. That was horsepower, coupled with the fact that Gordon had better exit speed off the turn that preceded that straightaway.
Well, where did all this burst of power suddenly come from?
Well, is it a burst of power by Johncock on the left of your screen, or is something wrong with Mears? You see, that's, we can't tell. The speeds are still very high. They're about 195 at this point. So I assume Mears' car is all right.
Of course, we can't count Sneva out of it. In third place, car number seven, because he was easily powerful enough to take the lead and keep it. There he is, going through in the white car.
Yeah.
And Pancho Carter still lurking in the background in case anything would happen.
Well, it'll be interesting to see how Mears does following Johncock. The different aerodynamic characteristics of these cars. Sometimes a car works better when you're not immediately in the wake of another car. Others seem to work just fine in the wake of another car.
Of course, Johncock is a Wildcat car, and Mears is a Penske.
And for that matter, Sneva is a March. So there's three different types of cars right there on the screen.
Although they're all ultra-modern, each one has a really different design. Each man has different ideas. Designer comes into play very much here as a technician and as an artist. These are the three leaders again. Johncock on front. Rick Mears second. Chris Economaki, in fact, did a piece for us about the shape of these cars, particularly the noses. Here it is.
For many years, the shape of the Indianapolis car reflected a single designer's thinking. Some had Coke bottle-shaped bodies, some had wedge shape. Some were long, some were short. But with the advent of aerodynamics, the designs have become standardized. I'm standing with three of 1982's first-line cars. This one here, a March 82C that A.J. Foyt has chosen. Here, a Penske PC-10, Rick Mears' pole-winning car. And here, a Wildcat 8B. Chosen by 1973 winner Gordon Johncock. Let's take a look at the rear wings now. They're all essentially the same height, the same distance back from the car. The engines and turbocharger units are all mounted essentially in the same place in the car, towards the rear. Directly in front of the engine, about here, on all three of the cars is the fuel tank, as narrow as the center section and this high, holds 40 gallons. No difference there. And the side pods on each of the cars come out, under which the ground effects treatment is generated. But then we get to the front, and here is where the designers differ. The Wildcat has, you might call it a screwdriver nose. The PC-10, a needle nose. And the March, well, a W.C. Fields bulbous nose. And the way the PC-10 has been running this year, it figures that next year, all the Indianapolis cars may well have needle noses.
Okay, Chris Economaki discussing the noses of race cars, but there's Johncock still in front. We have ourselves a story and an automobile race here today. Gordon Johncock leading. Remember, he won this race once. There is Mears making a move on him, side by side almost, but Gordy shuts him off.
I don't have to tell you how dangerous this is, Jim. Two drivers, brilliant drivers, battling for the lead as they come up through slower traffic, unknown air current moving. Then trying to feel each other out. The race is getting fairly near the end. It's a very difficult situation.
This is automobile race driving at its best, and as you say, at its most dangerous. These two men, Johncock by far the more experience at age 45. Foot Mears, a former winner at age 30 of the Indianapolis 500. Both of them former winners. Each has won once. Johncock's victory slightly tainted in 1973 by the fact that the race was shortened by rain. There they are.
Very different in background. Mears with his off-road background. Gordon Johncock used to running four-lap sprints on short ovals. So their whole way of thinking about racing is different.
But a lot of thinking going on in the race cars and the pits at this minute. Here's to catch him. Very, very doubtful. But it sure isn't over yet.
Well, there it is.
They give him three. We get less than that. We get about 2.5.
Okay, I don't think...
You don't need to measure seconds. You can see them.
You see it now. Will traffic be a problem? One of the Winningtons is ahead of them at this stage. Remember, if Mears catches him, he's still going to have to pass it.
Sam, we've got a trophy dash to the finish line. If this stays this way, there's never been anything like it. The closest finish in the history of Indianapolis in 1937, 2.16 seconds. There's Dina Mears. Her man is the man that's closing on the leader.
Yep. Look at Mears pour it on, Jim. I know. You can feel that guy ahead of you. And look at Mears now. Here's Johncock taking a fairly moderate line. And Mears is catching. Look at his speed off that turn.
I've never seen anything like it. There they go. Two laps to go. There's time to catch him if he can do it. Pick Mears. His wife. The stopwatch. 0.63 seconds between them.
I don't have to tell you what's going to happen if he catches him. It's going to be, I mean, this is extremely dangerous business right here.
I don't think I've ever seen an open wheel car race with people this close at the finish.
No, and never fun. And never so fast. I mean, these laps in the high 190.
Look at this.
Dina there. All right.
He may do it.
Yeah, he may. He's that close. Look at that shallow, shallow line.
They're going to get the right flag. There'll be one left to go. As he moves along. Job of staying ahead of him in turn one when he made that move there.
Good. That was brilliant.
Not quite over. Johncock still with the lead.
Here it comes
again.
Head
up to the finish line.
Here
he's still
again.
Closing. That's his wife.